head, and I have privilege to announce Roberto Frega, who finished his PhD at University Paris 8. He's a philosopher and also a senior researcher at CNRS, French National Center for Scientific Research in Paris. He has published two monographs on John Dewey's philosophy, Pensée, Expérience, Pratique, Essai sur la théorie du jugement de John Dewey. In 2006, John Dewey et la philosophie comme l'épistémologie de la pratique, Paris 2006, a book on political epistemology, Voci della Regione, in 2009, then also a book on social theories of normativity, Le source sociale de la normativité, in 2013, and a book on pragmatist moral and political philosophy, Practice, Judgment, and the Challenge of Moral and Political Disagreement, a Pragmatist Account, in 2012. And more than 30 articles on contemporary moral and political philosophy. Besides several edited volumes on pragmatist philosophy, he has also edited and translated a selection of Dewey's epistemological essays, Philosophia Sperimentale, Teoria Naturalistica della, and this is a tough one, Conscienza del Pensiero, in 2008. He is a co-executive editor of the European Journal of Pragmatism and American Philosophy. So without further ado, I give you Roberto Frega.
So my talk today, I mean, the title, the Normativity of Democracy, was given because I've been thinking quite a lot lately on what does it mean to say that democracy is a normative concept. Of course, I guess we everybody agree that on the fact that democracy is a normative concept, but what does exactly mean is to me somehow unclear, of course, beyond a sort of common sense assumption. The reason which motivates me which motivated me to begin this research was that in a sense I was persuaded that there was something insufficiently explored in the way the notion of democracy was being used, is being used in political philosophy and in the political sciences, and two of the possible consequences, I think, or I think can come from my reflection on what does it mean that democracy is a normative concept, are on the one hand that it may help us to reach a fuller understanding in a sort of hermeneutical movement, although I don't have a specific or a particular sympathy for hermeneutics in general, and. And then on the other hand, it may help us maybe to better understand why, for example, processes of the so-called third wave of democratization, in fact, are developing as it was expected, and maybe reflecting on what democracy is and what does it mean that democracy has a normative content. May help us understanding why things are happening the way they do. So, and I will begin by distinguishing two senses of normativity, particularly for the political domain, and the core of my argument will be precisely on this distinction. So, according to a first and a widely shared view, a concept is normative when it provides a benchmark against which to assess actions, events, or states of affairs. This conception is generally formulated in terms of norm compliance. According to this view, a concept is normative when it provides a norm against which a portion of reality can be evaluated. In the domain of politics, to which the concept of democracy, of course, belongs, the concept of pleasure, utility, equality, freedom, justice, and dominations, or non-domination, are normative in that sense. And in fact, you can see that each one of them provides a standard against which the value or appropriateness of an action, event, or state of affairs can be assessed in forms that are politically relevant. So when we say, for example, that an institution is organized according to criteria of social equality, that a regime is just, that a constitution respects human freedom, or that a social arrangement enables individuals to pursue their utility or their happiness, we are using these concepts in a normative way. We use them to assess an action, event, or set of affairs, and to assign its positive value. And of course, democracy is clearly a normative concept in that sense. As you can see, when we say that a regime, an organization, or a procedure is democratic or undemocratic, what we mean is precisely that this regime, organization, or procedure is politically good or bad, and the concept of democracy specifies in what sense good or bad should be meant. So this first conception of normativity, I call it non-compliance for this reason. And so far, I think there is nothing particularly problematic. But there is also, I think, a second sense in which a political concept can be said to have normative content. And according to the second view, a normative concept is one that provides general guidance in interpreting human reality. So you see, you are shifting toward a quite different understanding of what normative means. A concept that is normative in the second sense has the capacity to provide a comprehensive paradigm within which not only the whole of political reality, but also the other major normative concept can be accounted for. The second sense of normativity cannot be reduced to the dimension of non-compliance. Indeed, it is in a sense, I would say, it denotes a concept which is endowed with a capacity for intellectual orientation. As such, it does not merely set a standard against which a given event or set of affairs can be assessed. This was the meaning of the norm compliance normativity. But more than that, it helps structuring a broad domain of experience and organizing its overall normative content. Now, if we look at the history of political ideas, we observe that only few concepts have historically exercised a paradigmatic normative capacity. And essentially, I would say, only freedom, justice, and non-domination have succeeded in this task. At least if you look at the political philosophy in the 20th century, this is so. And the basis of my reflection here is that democracy, which hasn't been so far been considered as a paradigm normative concept, can play this role too. So my idea is to try to see what would be the implication of taking seriously this idea that democracy, and first of all, what would it mean to say that democracy is a paradigm normative concept and not merely a norm compliance normative concept? And what would be, on the one hand, the implication of taking this theoretical position, and on the other hand, which kind of concept of democracy we need if we want this concept to play this theoretical function? Because of course, not any concept of democracy would be suited to this task. Now, a first and apparently obvious, but you will see with a sort of relevant implications, corollary of the claim that democracy has paradigm normative content is that the scope of the concept of democracy far exceeds the domain of the theory of government. And because only in this way, of course, you can use democracy in the same way in which you use justice or freedom or non-domination as a concept which can be predicated of a larger domain of social affairs. Now, I don't have the time to... Do you have some water? Maybe here. To enter into the detail of this, but I think it's quite easy to understand in what sense we have seen it here. By the way, justice or non-domination are in fact can be in fact be predicated of a quite wide array of social situations which exceed the domain of formal political institutions. And so introducing the distinction between norm compliance and paradigm normativity makes visible the apparent paradox according to which, while today democracy has achieved the unrivaled political standing, this we have seen it also throughout this conference. By standing, I mean as a normative standard, of course, not as a achieved reality. Only in the sense that everybody calls himself a democrat today, or or nearly everybody. And while democracy and democratization studies are constantly on the rise, if you see things from the point of view of the academia and of studies, its normative content is systematically framed in the theoretical terms of other normative notions such as justice, freedom, or non-domination. And indeed, it is an evidence, at least to me, that political philosophy has rarely considered democracy as the paradigmatic normative concept deputed to the task of structuring the whole conceptual field of politics. You just have to think how the liberal theory has traditionally assigned this task to the concept of liberty and then since roles to the concept of justice, or how critical theory or Marxism or republicanism have rather assigned non-domination, this sort of overarching normative function. And although, of course, these traditions are thoroughly committed to democratic ideals and institutions, such a commitment is the indirect and derivative result of a prior endorsement either of justice or of non-domination as paradigm normative concept. And as a consequence of this methodological way of proceeding, in all these traditions, the concept of democracy plays only a limited and subordinated role, and tends to be confined to the domain of the theory of government, mainly. And one in this perspective can, for example, derive a justification of democracy from Rawls' theory of justice under the assumption that democracy is the political regime that best fulfills the requirement of a just basic structure of society. And in the same way, Pettit and other Republicans have argued that a democratic political regime is a regime that better than any other establishes the condition under which non-domination can thrive. So we always have this indirect justification of the legitimacy of democracy under the banner, so to say, of an independent, different normative criteria. And in this sense, democracy is being considered as a norm compliance and not as a paradigm normative concept. And more, I think that even more than the history of the 20th century political philosophy shows, this way of, in fact, considering democracy has been quite dominant since Aristotle's time, although you have some exception to which I will come later. And now, when you try to look for this greater scope for a political normative concept, or to try to scale it up from the norm compliance to the paradigm level, you have two possible strategies, it seems to me. Maybe three, but the third one is less interesting to me now, which would be a moral strategy, which doesn't really interest me. So the first strategy consists in identifying democracy with a set of political procedures or principles, and then extending their reach beyond the realm of formal politics. To this extent, one could, for example, identify democracy with inclusive and deliberative forms of decision making, and extend the scope of the concept of democracy to all these institutions and situations within which decisions are taken according to democratic procedures. So enlarging the scope would consist in taking this political content and showing that this political content can be applied also outside formal political institutions. And this is typically what theories of democratic participation or of democratic deliberation do. Methodologically, the strategy begins with the political concept of democracy and then proceeds to extend its reach to the social domain. This is the relevant move of this family of strategies. But you have also a second and to me more interesting, or at least this is the road I suggest we can pursue to reach this goal, which consists in beginning by defining democracy as a social category and not as a political one. One that describes broader societal phenomena of which political democracy is only a specification. And provides a different way of, if you want, derive by a sort of genealogical methodology, political category from their social use. So if you see, it's a reverse strategy compared to the other one. And this is the route I'm trying to follow here, a route which has some historical examples, which are on the one end the Tocquevillian tradition. Of course, Alexis de Tocqueville himself, but also Claude Lefort, which I consider a sort of a later Tocquevillian. Lefort particularly developed this idea of democracy as a form of society, and his intuition was precisely this one. And then, of course, you have the same or similar intuitions within the pragmatist tradition. And if you take, for example, John Dewey's idea of democracy as a way of life, I take it to be articulating the same intuition that you can, or that you methodologically should start by a social conception of democracy, and then from there develop a political notion. This kind of move you can find it in both Lefort and Dewey. So. When it comes about how to do this from a theoretical point of view, my idea is that a promising strategy, which means this is a possible one but not necessarily the only one, consists in trying to combine two parts. On the one hand, you should start from the baseline of what I would call social interactions, and to identify interactional patterns or patterns of social interaction of which the concept of democracy can be predicated, and then taking this as the building block of a wider theory of democracy. Then there is a second stage which is articulated to this first one, which is a social ontology of democracy. And the idea is that this social ontology should build on these social interactionist micro foundations, expanding the scope of the concept of democracy to the largest possible domains of social life, from basic face-to-face interaction to formal political institutions. And the idea of an ontology of democracy is precisely that you should be able to describe the different layers or strata which constitute a society in a more or less formal way. So as I use the term here, a social ontology is a theory which describes the basic layers that compose social life. As I conceive it, social ontology is built on micro-sociological foundation that can be provided by a theory of social interactions. And you can think at the social interactionist tradition, if those of you who know it, of the Chicago School of Sociology, partly also of the tradition of American ethnomethodology, and then of what Irving Goffman has been doing lately. All there you have different schools of what I would call social interactionists, which has been in analyzing society as a sort of system of patterns of interaction involving two or more individuals in presence or distance situations. And the baseline of the argument I'm trying to develop is that for an ontology to provide the building block of a paradigmatic normative theory of democracy, so we come again to this idea of paradigmatic normative democracy, the normative properties which are displayed by basic social interaction should be inherited by more complex and higher layers of social ontology. This is, of course, quite a demanding thesis. Now, of course, this inheriting property should hold also for this specific normative property, which is democracy, or democratic, if you want to use it in an adverbial way, which would be more appropriate given the context. Hence, the properties which specify under which conditions social interactions are democratic provide the contents upon which we can generalize the normative use of the concept of democracy in ways consistent with its use as a paradigm normative framework. So the first immediate question which comes to everyone's mind is, which are then these traits or qualities which qualify a social interaction as being democratic? What is that which defines the democratic nature of social interactions? And to answer this question, as I've already anticipated, it seems to me that rather than Tocqueville, it is to authors like Charles Horton Cooley or George Herbert Mead or John Dewey that we have to turn. Because according to these and other social pragmatists, social thinkers, democracy denotes precisely a specific type of social interaction whose paradigmatic example is offered by the horizontal, free, equal, and reason-based form of exchange which takes place within primary groups. This is an idea you find across all this generation or two generations of social thinkers which were directly or indirectly related to the School of Chicago at the beginning of the 20th century. And without being exhaustive, these are the traits which in a recurrent way come as a description of the democratic nature of interactions. Prima facie preference for horizontal and symmetrical patterns of interaction, which means that hierarchy and symmetry needs always to be justified to those to whom they are imposed. Promotion of cooperative relations which acknowledge the reality of interdependence. Equal participation in practice of inquiry and decision making. Privilege of deliberation over other methods for taking decisions. Effective integration in social practices. Successful integration between the functional dimension of problem solving and the expressive dimension of self-realization, which is another quite typical feature of pragmatist social theory. And if you want to give a sort of more synthetic picture of these different descriptions, basically they can come up to two major traits. The most classical one consists in promoting autonomy, while the second, and often discarded, concerns the role of this interaction in shaping individuals' identity. Which means that this interaction fulfills at the same time functional and expressive needs, which is an important argument for explaining why, for example, according to this tradition, a social approach to democracy, I will come to this later also, it's not merely enabling for political democracy, it's constitutive, which is quite a major difference. So of course this kind of democratic patterns of social interaction can be present in all the dimensions of social life, within the family, in the group of friends, in the workplace, in learning environments, within all type of organizations, and up to the level of constitutional architecture. On the one hand, they structure informal relationship among acquaintances as well as among strangers. And this is the purely interactional dimension, if you wish. And on the other hand, they are also embodied in organizational routines and in form of institutional design. This is the more organization, more institutional dimension of, which in a way helps completing this process of ontological inheritance of properties. Because of course you go from informal interaction to their embodiment in routines, to their formalization in procedures, and so on and so forth. And so you have there the sociological explanation of how inheritance of properties can happen. So it should be noted that while properties of interaction can be inherited by different social layers, this heredity is not something which goes without saying or in a simplistic way or simply by a replication of identical models, but it's something which may be difficult to achieve and usually requires complex social arrangements. In other terms, the social embedding of democracy requires a sophisticated sociological imagination and the capacity to innovate. And one way of expressing this idea in the pragmatist tradition, for example, has been that of discussing democracy as being experimental, which is this idea of democratic experimentalism as being at the same time as being mainly a theory of political but also of social institutions. I can come back to this if you want during the discussion. And then, of course, a social ontology of democracy, this is something I'm not going to do here, but should nevertheless explain under which conditions the democratic properties of these basic social interactions are preserved and expanded outside the circle of primary relations, and which are the requirements this expansion imposes upon the different social spheres. Now, just to give you a sort of exemplification of what would it mean to develop a social ontology of democracy, we can identify some basic layers of the social ontology. And the first one, of course, is this of the social interaction which takes place among individuals, and therefore individual habits are the deposit of social learning. In that sense, democratic habits define the basic layer of a democratic ontology. Habits themselves have an individual and social dimension. On the one hand, there are individual habits such as the capacity to engage in cooperative discussion, a sort of, if you want, a presupposition of rational communication, if you want to say this in a Habermasian term. This was also a critique of Richard Bernstein to Habermas, explaining in what sense a democratic ethos is necessarily presupposed. By his idea of communicative rationality. Then you have a second layer, which is composed of primary groups, such as the family, the group of friends, and other forms of spontaneous groupings, which take place on the everyday basis, and whose basis is essentially affective. Here, too, democracy qualifies a form of interaction based on equality of relations and cooperative forms of exchange. A third social ontological layer is composed of informal associations such as networks of solidarity. A fourth layer consists of these voluntary associations in which membership is free and the level of obligation generally low. So you see, in a way, we are sort of going toward a more structured way of, toward more structured pattern of social interaction. Charities, NGOs, neighborhood associations, urban centers belong to this category. Then at a higher level, we find more structured forms of interaction which take the form of stable organizations, which rules entry and exit conditions, and which impose higher constraints on individuals' behavior. Then at a still higher level of abstraction, we find institutions such as the educational system, the army, the church, the state, and the public administration. These institutions partly compose the political system as a system which cater for individual and collective needs. And here, too, you can have this democratic question in terms of how patterns of democratic interaction are implemented or not implemented. And then, of course, at I would say the highest or the most, maybe not the most general, but the closest to the purely political understanding of democracy, you have, of course, the constitutional architecture of the political powers. So the idea is that at each of these levels, the idea of democracy can play a normative role. But of course, the requirements that each of these social aggregates need to fulfill to be democratic are, of course, different. So you are not going to be democratic in the same way within an informal group of friends and in the functioning of a political parliament, for example. But the interesting point is that at all this level, you can define the attribute democratic by referring back to its capacity to implement or promote, and the difference here that implementing means realizing within itself, so practicing these patterns, and promoting means enabling conditions of creating condition of possibility for these patterns to exist elsewhere. And therefore, having in view the capacity of these different institutions to achieve social inclusion and decisional parity, which are the two principles which, in a way, summarize all the seven democratic traits I listed before. So one way, I think, to understand what exactly is the meaning of social inclusion and and decisional parity is to leave aside for a moment the more classical legalistic frame of contemporary debates about equality and inclusion, which would be the first that would come to mind discussing these ideas. To go back to the history of modern Europe, and particularly to the historical process that have brought about the transition from society of ancien regime to modern democratic societies, which was, of course, the historical event who prompted Tocqueville to write Democracy in America, but who is still a quite living source of motivation also for later generation, like the pragmatists I was evoking before, or also for scholars like philosophers like Claude Lefort, who goes back quite often and regularly either to the French Revolution or simply to Tocqueville as a thinker. Now, comparing ancien regime to contemporary society gives us a clue about the paradigmatic content of democracy. This is the point for doing this. And in fact, democracy identifies a social and political project based on the idea that prima facie, all social relations should be based on horizontal forms of authority, and that all forms of social separation in self-enclosed groups should be dismantled. This was an essential part of the democratic project embedded in the French Revolution. As is known, societies of ancien regime were based on the opposite on the opposite principle. A well-ordered society was a society in which individuals were clearly assigned to static and unchanging social estates, and the relationship among them were determined by their social position. Social exclusion and hierarchical authority were the legitimate principles which organized the whole society, from the level of intimate family relations to that of formal political institutions. So here, in this shift, you see a sense of what would it mean, or what did it mean, to conceive democracy as a paradigmatic normative principle, or in Lefort's term, as I said, as a form of society, as not merely as a form of a type of government. And this, it is, of course, in contrast with this idea of a well-ordered society, which for us is absolutely not well-ordered, that democracy emerges as an alternative, incompatible, revolutionary pattern of social organization. And it is in that sense that it denotes a form of society rather than a political regime. What stands at the heart of the democratic principle of social inclusion and decisional parity is, therefore, a pre-political idea of participation, one that is perhaps better expressed by the term of partaking rather than that of participation. Partaking means being socially and morally included in the concrete activities of a community. And again, which is important, is concrete activities and not merely taking decision about what is to be done. Now, of course, this idea of partaking includes participation in decision making, which is the Enlightenment core of autonomy. But also, and in a more basic way, it means unrestrained access to social practices and spaces. So according to this view, the attribute democratic can appropriately be used not only to assess the state of formal political institutions, as when we speak, for example, of defective or delegative democracies in political science. More than that, and certainly with a different explanatory intention, we can legitimately discuss the democratic quality of different societies, having in mind the patterns of social interaction that shape them. So if we accept such a view, we are then entitled to say that the attribute undemocratic, or democratic accordingly, applies not only to societies whose regimes fail to comply with normative requirements such as those established by Freedom House. More radically than that, undemocratic societies are societies in which access to social spaces and practices is determined by group identity, societies in which status determines patterns of authority, in which someone's social standing, gender, age, ethnicity determines his or her position in a social interaction. Within an undemocratic society, it is these and similar norms of social interaction that determine someone's position in the family, in the interaction with his or her partner, or in the workplace. But they determine also the places he or she can access and those by which he or she is formally or informally excluded. So you see how you shift continuously from the private to the public, from the social to the political, in a very continuous way. So in this sense, you can have this apparent paradox that a country is fully democratic according to a political measure, but at the same time undemocratic according to a social understanding like the one I'm discussing. So before concluding, let me come back to the original question which motivated my search for a paradigmatic use for the concept of democracy. In advocating a space for democracy besides or an alternative to justice and non-domination, this remains quite an open question. I have in mind some theoretical advantages such a move can deliver, and these advantages, to my mind, comes because of the peculiar normative content democracy has compared to justice or non-domination. So you have some element of irreducibility. And I'm just listing some. One concern, the explanation of what social cooperation is. Theories of justice, especially those with a heavy distributive bent, have been explicit in connecting justice with social cooperation. This is no surprise and nothing new. But these theories tend, however, to conceive cooperation exclusively in terms of its just terms, and in so doing underestimate the normative relevance of the trade-off between functional and expressive requirement. A theory of democracy offers a richer account of social cooperation than that usually found in theories of justice, which is also a way of saying that the legalistic understanding is probably insufficient. Another element, which of course is much stressed in much more emphasized by within a paradigmatic understanding of democracy, concern the importance of the social political regime for the constitution of individual identity, which is not necessarily at the core of theories of justice and non-domination. Now, of course, with the exception of recognitional theories of justice, which, on the other hand, have a stronger bent in this direction, both justice-based and non-domination-based theories heavily underestimate the function of social interactions in shaping individual and collective identities. By focusing on the normative qualities of justice and non-domination as ends that each social interaction should pursue, they neglect other normatively equally important goals of social interaction. In that sense, they have a too weak understanding of the social dimension of normativity. A third dimension, which in a way starting from a democracy first approach to political philosophy helps understand, concerns the dimension of learning meant as a sort of basic feature of a dynamic democratic society. And in fact, democracy as a form of life or as a form of society based on horizontal cooperation is generally or can be described as being defined by a sort of sustained capacity for self-correction. So this idea of self-correction of social learning is in fact definitional of a democratic way of functioning or of a democratic pattern of interaction. And the ideas of learning and of experimentalism are constitutive of an understanding of democracy, at least one which comes from the pragmatist tradition I'm illustrating here. And maybe another and last is personal self-fulfillment. Theories of justice and non-domination emphasize the formal conditions that enable individuals to formulate and pursue their goals or their rational plans of life. While, in a way, this idea of democracy as a way of life has what I would call its own recompense in the inclusive and equality-based interaction which defines its course. We don't have this means and explanation of non-domination or just in being the condition of possibility for something else, which is the pursuit of one's own life goals. But it is the fact that the simple fact of being involved in the democratic rather than undemocratic social interaction is a good in itself, I would say. So I want to conclude with a remark which concerns the implication of this wide view of democracy for the empirical study of democratizations. There has been a tendency in political science to accept a dichotomy between what can be called hardware-based and software-based approaches to democracy. Hardware-based approaches consider that the very heart of democracy lies in the formal political institutions and tend to rely on and produce data about the evolution of democracies in terms of their electoral performances and implementation of other hardwired properties. I guess you are more or less familiar with this literature. Software-based approaches tend, on the other hand, to emphasize the cultural dimension of politics and to see in the diffusion of democratic values either the prerequisite or the very essence of democratization. Now, a social account of democracy is different from, distinguish itself from both these approaches. And indeed, it seems to me that taking seriously this social interactionist basis of democracy may open a sort of third way in studying process of democratization, according to which democracy describes first and foremost neither values nor formal institutions, but specific patterns of social interaction like the one I've been indicating. And these patterns, in their turn, confirm or consolidate political values and promote the development of formal political institutions which are in tune with them. So you have a sort of sociological explanation of how the three dimensions of values, institutions, and social practices are connected together with the priority of what happens in social interactions. This view goes beyond the mere statement of a congruence requirement between hardware and software, or between values and institutions. In fact, it says that both values and institutions find their origin and their meaning in the concrete ways in which people experience democracy in their lives. In that sense, one should consider the democratic patterns of social interaction as being constitutive rather than merely enabling conditions for the existence of democracy, which once again is a significant difference with theories of democratization of democracy, which search in the society a sort of mere embedding for formal political institutions. This is, I think, the important distinction between enabling and constitutive. Only at these conditions we will be able to vindicate the idea of democracy as describing a societal project whose seeds have been sown in Europe. This was the historical part I was evoking before, but whose reach is in principle unlimited. Now, in conclusion, democracy, as the name of a form of society, denotes the project of an inclusive society of equals, which certainly cannot exist without the spread of shared values and appropriate institutions, but whose core ideas consist rather in these egalitarian and inclusive patterns of social interaction. Thank you.